Good morning, and welcome to Our Lady of the Lakes. This morning, we celebrate Palm Sunday of the Passion of the Lord. Father Gene will begin the liturgy in the back of church, where he will bless the palms. You will be able to pick yours up as you leave church after communion. We know that you have no books to follow, but we invite you to sing along with the Mass parts and the hymns with us as you are able.
Good morning.
Good morning, Father.
Once again, we are victims of the virus, and our celebration is not what we have come to know, and it's not as celebratory as we have done in past years, but it's the best we can do at this point. So this is our procession. This is our palm procession for the day, and we are glad to have them. You can see that they are exceptional young men. Okay, let's begin. Good. Good. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you always.
And with your spirit.
My friends, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Together, today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of the Lord's Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered into his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city of our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross in his resurrection and in his life. Almighty ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him, who live and reign forever and ever.
And amen.
This is a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus and his disciples drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately on entering it, you will find a colt tethered on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone should say to you, 'Why are you doing this?' reply, 'The master has need of it and will send it back here at once.' So they went off and found a colt tethered at a gate outside on the street, and they untied it. Some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They answered them just as Jesus had told them to, and they permitted them to do it. So they brought the colt to Jesus and put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. Those preceding him as well as those following kept crying out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is to come. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay.
Hosanna to the Son of David. Oh, blessed is he, oh, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Rejoice, daughter of Zion, in the one who brings great joy. Sing praise, children of Judah, is he, oh blessed is he, who comes in the name of the Lord. Rejoice, O following, who behold the face of God. Sing praise, children of Judah, for the Lord is close at hand. Oh, Hosanna.
We have music in our church. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We're going to be doing the Passion now, right?
We're going to do the readings first.
We have a reading first. Pay no attention to the man in the mask.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
But you, O Lord, be not far. midst of the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, give glory to him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. My God, why have you abandoned me?
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found in human appearance, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name, which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
The Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were to take place in 2 days' time. So the chief priests and the scribes were seeking a way to arrest him by treachery and put him to death. They said,
"Not during the festival, for fear that there may be a riot among the people."
When he was in Bethany reclining at table in the house of Simeon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of perfumed oil, costly, genuine spikenard. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it on his head. There were some who were indignant.
Why has there been this waste of perfumed oil? It could have been sold for more than 300 days' wages and the money given to the poor.
They were infuriated with her. Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you make trouble for her? She has done a good thing for me. The poor you will always have with you, and whenever you wish, you can do good to them. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anticipated anointing my body for burial. Amen, I say to you, Wherever the gospel is proclaimed to the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her.
Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand him over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He sent two of his disciples and said to them,
"Go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a jar of water. Follow him wherever he enters. Say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room where I will eat the Passover with my disciples?' Then he will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there."
The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and to say to him one by one,
"Surely it is not I."
He said to them,
"One of the 12, the one who dips with me into the dish. For the Son of Man indeed goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
While they were eating, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, and said,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
Then after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"All of you will have your faith shaken, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed.' But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be."
Then Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he vehemently replied,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And they all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch."
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible the hour might pass him by. He said,
"Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will."
When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open and did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Then, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely."
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
"Rabbi."
And he kissed him. And they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I was with you teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me, but that the scriptures would be fulfilled."
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body, they seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard and was seated with the guards, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, alleging,
"We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple made with hands, and within 3 days, I will build another not made with hands.'"
Even so, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned Jesus, saying,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But he was silent and answered nothing. Again the high priest asked him and said to him,
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Then Jesus answered,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
At that the high priest tore his garments and said,
"What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
They all condemned him as deserving to die. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him,
"Prophesy."
And the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's maids came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said,
"You too were with the Nazarene Jesus."
But he denied it, saying,
"I neither know nor understand what you are talking about."
So he went out into the outer court. Then the cock crowed. The maid saw him and began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
Once again he denied it. A little later, the bystanders said to Peter once more,
"Surely you are one of them, for you too are a Galilean."
He began to curse and to swear,
"I do not know this man about whom you are talking."
And immediately a cock crowed a second time. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times." He broke down and wept. As soon as morning came, the chief priests with the elders and the scribes, that is, the whole Sanhedrin, held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
The chief priests accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned him,
"Have you no answer? See how many things they accuse you of."
Jesus gave him no further answer, so that Pilate was amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, he used to release them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was then in prison along with the rebels who had committed murder in a rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
"Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?"
for he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
"Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the King of the Jews?"
They shouted again,
"Crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
They only shouted the louder,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them. And after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the praetorium, and assembled the whole cohort. They clothed him in purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
and kept striking his head with a reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simeon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. They crucified him and divided his garments by casting lots for them to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." With him they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself by coming down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which is translated,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"Look, he is calling Elijah."
One of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to take him down."
Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. The veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was the Son of God."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of the younger James and of Joseph, and Salomon. These women had followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was the day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council, who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came and courageously went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Having bought a linen cloth, he took him down, wrapped him in the linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, watched where he was laid.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It's just one little line in the middle of a very intense gospel. But it said that Pilate was amazed that Jesus was already dead. He only lasted about, we think, according to our tradition, about 3 hours on the cross. And crucifixion was meant to be a very long, drawn-out torture. And it often would go for more than a day. And so Pilate was surprised at that. And but the treatment that Jesus had received over the past day and night made him just exhausted. I mean, just completely spent. And we believe strongly that Jesus was truly man. He was human. And of all the torments that Jesus suffered in those hours, the thing that I think troubles me most is the abandonment that, except for the women, of course, everyone else had abandoned him, had run away. And in his last moments, having lived the very best life that he could, having done exactly what his father told him to do, he cried out, "My God, why have you abandoned me?" Can you imagine that kind of suffering? Can you imagine it? We've all been betrayed by friends. This is part of life. But not like this. Not like this. The suffering that he experienced as a man, as a human being, is unlike anything that I can imagine or can imagine for anyone else. Only he, in his divinity, devised a death like this. Everything that happened was according to God's plan. But Jesus didn't know that he was God. He didn't know it. There's nowhere in Scripture an indication that he knew he was God. And so he was there all alone, in all unimaginable torment. How do we respond? What can we say to him? What can we say to him? God bless you all. As one community, let us send up our prayers and petitions to Almighty God. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As one community, let us send up our prayers and petitions to Almighty God.
For the whole church, uniting with one heart and voice to escort our Savior with palms and praises to the holy city, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For individuals, groups, and nations who, like Jesus, have been cruelly betrayed by a false gesture of peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the courage to look long and steadily at our crucified God, who in his humble divine love for us endured the pain-filled silence of his cross, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the intentions we bring in our hearts to this holy sacrifice, for all who have asked for our prayers, and for our beloved departed ones, especially Art and Rose Dowd, for whom this Mass is offered, along with all who have passed through the doors of death with Jesus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, hear and grant these petitions. We ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives forever and ever.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this wine to offer. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Wash away my iniquities and cleanse me of all my sins. Pray, my friends, that your sacrifice and mine will be acceptable to Almighty God.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Thank you.
made holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness, make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. As we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, James, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, her holy spouse, Saint Joseph, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. I have one announcement. We're going to be starting a group of Alcoholics Anonymous here in the library. It'll start off in the library and then hopefully it will grow so that we have to go into the fellowship hall. That'll be Tuesday nights for the foreseeable future at 6:30. Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Bow your heads and ask for God's blessing. Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Crucified my Lord. remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.